Good morning. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar about how to create a Cassandra data model. This is Jeff Carpenter, developer advocate here at DataStax, and I'm here with Patrick McFadin.
What's up, Jeff? We're doing it live.
We're doing it live. This is going to be so awesome.
Yeah, I think this is the right way to do it. This is the way.
Before I joined DataStax, I was a developer and an architect and possibly in a role similar to what you might find yourself in right now. So in a situation where my CTO said, hey, let's check out Cassandra and use it. We had a great guy, Wei Deng, came over from DataStax and taught me how to data model.
Speaking of, this is the way.
That's right.
Yeah, he is amazing. So yeah, if you ever go to a conference or anything and see Wei is on the ticket, go see his talk. Yeah.
Awesome. So all I'm saying is once I was in your shoes, so how did you get into this space? Why don't you do a little introduction of yourself, Patrick?
Well, how did I get into the Cassandra data modeling space?
Uh-huh.
From the beginning? let's see. When I started with Cassandra, it was around 0.8, 0.7. And the only thing we had at the time was Thrift. And so it was a key value, basically. And I wrote the first, some of the first presentations on data modeling during that. And it was a lot harder. I was part of the group that was trying to make SQL a thing. So I worked on the SQL spec.
Ah, Cassandra Query Language.
Right.
Because before it was cool.
Before it was cool, Eric Evans, when Cassandra PMC committer was first one, because the SQL 1.0 was out there, and we were all like, this could be the right direction, and as we developed it. So I got involved pretty early with SQL as a really easy and natural way to query and insert and everything. Probably arguable, like, wow, it looks a lot like SQL.
Right.
But that was kind of the point.
That's good. And that's why I'm glad that you joined me today, because if there's a problem in data modeling, you've probably seen it.
So or created it.
I'm going to hit you with some questions as we go through, and we'll share our collective wisdom. So
yeah.
why don't we just go ahead and stop looking at pictures of ourselves and get started?
Yeah, this is us. Yeah. And then moving on.
Okay, so as I mentioned, we did a previous webinar about a month ago about migrating from relational to Cassandra. And there was a little data modeling portion of that presentation that we did. And that was actually where we got the most questions from that webinar. So you see there, topic number two in the slide was adapting your data model. And guess where all the questions were? So we were like, this is an evergreen topic. People always have questions about data modeling. Let's do it. Let's do a deep dive and let's make it real. This is not a canned data modeling presentation of, academic techniques and stuff. This is like the data model for a real application is what we're going to look at. Are you down for that?
Yeah, and because we're doing a live, we can do the live Q&A as well.
That's right.
We have some pre-baked questions, which are probably ones you'll want to ask. So
just the classics.
The classics. So hold off a little bit on your questions. If you don't see a pop-up, go ahead and ask them. There will be some, but we're here to answer those.
So they should ask their question or they should not ask their question? That was really ambiguous.
Yeah, it was really ambiguous. We have pre-baked questions you'll see in slides. If this does not answer your questions, go ahead and pop them into the question area on the chat, and we'll try to get to those live.
Okay, this is our plan. We have data modeling here in a few short points. Five points
right
in our outline. Patrick was trying to make me turn it into four, and I was like, well, wrapping up is not really a point, right?
No, so we optimized.
Yeah.
Like awesome. Every good data model should be.
Well, premature optimization is not good. Okay.
Yeah, all right, you got me there.
Okay.
Computer
We're gonna talk
science
about
guy.
Why Cassandra data modeling is important. Why is this a topic that people want to know about? Just to set the stage for things. Then we're going to talk about how you start your data modeling process by identifying access patterns. And then part three is creating table designs based on those access patterns. And topic four is probably where we're going to have a lot of fun talking about how do you evaluate data models to know if they're good. This is where a lot of the tough questions start to come into play. And then we'll wrap some stuff up and tell you, share some resources where you can get more information on data modeling. Does that
yep.
sound like a plan?
This is a five-step plan.
Are you ready to dive into this bucket of awesome?
Let's dive into the bucket of awesome. Head first.
Bobbing for
awesome.
Awesome in the bucket.
This is a bad discussion.
bobbing
for awesome.
We got to bring a little bit of a dad joke vibe to this webinar.
Awesome apples. Let's go get some.
All right. Why is data modeling important, Patrick?
Why is that? Oh, it's the only thing that you'll do that will make or break your whole Cassandra experience. So there you go.
It's kind of important.
It's kind of important. What we assume, and based on Jeff's last webinar, we assume that you know about relational database modeling. And that's just because we've been doing this for a long time. And so far, I have not run into anyone who hasn't. If you've done anything with databases, it's probably been a relational database. And that's just because when we start as developers and we learn about data, you learn about how tables work and rows, and it's just part of the experiences we learn.
So, sure.
But you also learn about relational database modeling, which is where you take, you know, your data, you build out your models from that. So you do the which tables do you do on your normal forms, their normal forms, et cetera. And then when you build your application, you're building queries around that normalized data model. So this is when you're doing selects with joins and all those fancy things you can do with SQL.
Right.
But that, I think that is really comfortable for a lot of folks. And when you don't have that, you get kind of weird about it, but that's fine. We're going to walk you through the process. And this is a process. We get it. You came from this world. Now, I think that the problem is, of course, relational databases don't really fit into the world that we're trying to force our applications, right?
What's that world?
Well,
tell me about your world.
Large scale distributed applications.
Right.
That cloud have scale. No downtime.
Yep.
Yeah. We're building cloud native applications. And that takes a different kind of database. And a database that was built before the word cloud, when a cloud was the thing in the sky.
Right.
Yeah. It just doesn't fit. And so, yeah. So we're building applications. So what's the next step there?
So talk to me about the process. Like relational data modeling goes a certain prescribed way. We're thinking about our data models first before we ever, maybe long before we ever actually write any of our application, right?
Yeah. So this is where we get into the ERD. So we've got that.
Okay.
Here's a slide that's going to, trigger warning.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. So you should see, you should see on your screen the ERD, right? And the ERD is classic because this is also how we've learned. And over time, what I've seen is this is where anyone who works in large scale applications, like with a relational database, you show up here. And this is your crow's feet diagram.
You probably have a wall chart somewhere.
Oh, God. Printed on tabloid paper. And, you know, when you it's time to build your application, well, you go pray to it.
Hand-drawn modifications.
Yeah, exactly. And it's like, how do I... And then when you make a mistake, you're like, I could just join my way out of this. Right, Jeff?
No.
Yeah. Yeah, no, with a left inner join. I'm
Until
there.
You can't.
Yeah. And then you're like, in your third nested join and... Near DBA calls you and say, you just took every cycle out of my database. Why?
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. So relational, classic relational data modeling.
Yeah.
Top down, design your data model, find your entities, denormalize. Oh, and then we'll write the application later.
Yeah. Application comes dead last.
So let's contrast that.
Right. Yes. So now how would we do that with Cassandra, Jeff?
So with Cassandra, we flip that on its head. We start thinking about our application. We start thinking about what are the queries that I'm going to actually need in order to support this application. You might even have like a wireframe mock-up of your user interface is often a good starting point. So you think about what your application queries are going to need to be, then you design Cassandra tables to answer those queries. So we're optimizing for reads. We're going to design the table in such a way that it has exactly the data that we want to get back out to put it up on the, you know, in our app on our phone or in a web browser or wherever we're delivering our app. And then finally we create our SQL schema and go to town.
Yeah, there's probably a lot of familiar process in this.
Right.
But it's a different directionality. And I keep saying Cassandra is an application database. So that's where we should probably start.
Okay, let's do that. So a little bit of terminology here. If you're not familiar with the Cassandra query language and the way that Cassandra lays out data, Cassandra has a tabular data model. So you have tables and they're organized in rows and columns. The key innovation that Cassandra has introduced is this idea of the partition key and the clustering columns. So every row of data in Cassandra has a primary key
right.
that says where it lives.
Right.
And it has two components, One of them is required, the partition key that says where does that data go or what node. We'll see in a minute what nodes does that data live on. And then clustering columns are an organizational hack, basically, in the best sense of the word hack, that we can use.
That was a pretty harsh word, hack.
I don't know. I like it. That's the clever hack that's
organizational
behind this whole thing.
Feature.
Oh my gosh. Okay.
Fine.
Such a stickler for terminology. So this example table that is being shown on the slide here is okay. Populations.
Right.
So population numbers are an entity. What is the population of a city? And then it is partitioned by country, and then the city within the country is used as a clustering column. So what we'll see here is if I have data for 6 different countries, that might get allocated across my cluster to the different nodes such that I, hopefully, if I've chosen a good partition key, I'll have an even distribution of populations by city on each of the different nodes in my cluster.
And I think this is a transparency that we want to try to enhance, is that this is a feature of Cassandra, is your partition key distributes your data in a very nicely distributed way. I mean, it's very even. However, that's not something you really need to think about too much. If you stick to more of the basic rules of creating the right primary key with a partition key for each entity, and the primary key is, sure, this is a unique record, all these things happen for you.
Right. So you want to be conscious of,
right,
to some degree, like, of how is the data being divided up so that you can have a balanced cluster.
Right.
If I have, you know, maybe state isn't, or maybe country, if I have way more, if all 99% of my users are in one country, then I probably don't want to put all that in one partition.
For sure. And I think that's, you know, this is where we're going to get into, we have slides on this, like how to size our partitions and things like that. But underlying, this is what's going on. And if you want more of the below the scene, like the architectural diagrams and the technical details of how Cassandra works, there are plenty of resources for that.
So I'm just giving you the bottom line front of here's the things that you need to know about the primary key in Cassandra, which is, you know, arguably your most important data modeling choice.
Mm.
So that first component, partition key, tells how the data is sent out to the different nodes in the cluster. The second piece of that is within a partition, we have these optional clustering columns that show how the data is organized on disk. We take advantage of this so that we can have super fast reads. So the clustering column also identifies a unique row if I have a partition that has multiple rows in it. It helps identify each row uniquely, and I can use it to grab an individual row. Like I could go and grab the population of just New York,
mm-hmm,
or I could do a range query based on the clustering column that I've chosen. And maybe I have a query where I want to be able to get multiple cities back at the same time for my app within the same country. If I've grouped those together in a partition and use the city as the clustering column, then I can go and grab a range of cities. This is alphabetical ordering shown here, but you could do whatever ordering you really wanted based on the data that you chose as a clustering column.
And so the primary key consists of the partition key with clustering columns.
Right.
That is it.
And so to the extent that you should think about this, it's really how is the data being split apart across the cluster, and then how is it being organized within a partition that's stored on some node somewhere. These are really the two main things that you're thinking about, and the only reason that you're thinking about them is because you want your queries to be fast and scale really well.
Yeah, so that primary key, which I think is what we're talking about building, is the partition key and the clustering columns in combination create a unique record.
Right.
But then that partition key is really underlying, that's what really sets up this distributed database working well. And the clustering columns give you that little bit of order inside of your data model. But that primary key is the unique record for that table.
Okay, so just wanted to get some principles out there.
Good.
You're gonna see this in action as we go through the remainder of these slides. So
yeah,
let's go through the process with a real application.
Yeah.
So we're gonna start with identifying access patterns.
Let's do that. Okay.
All right, so how do we do that?
So what you'll see here is this is a killer video. This is a website a reference application that we created a long time ago. And what it is just a video sharing website. And this is, we're going to walk through it and use this as an example of this is a real thing.
Actually, you can go there right now if you want.
You can. You can go to killervator.com, and that's no E in the killer. But if you go there, there's a great little tour that you can go on, and it'll show you, oh, well, this button right here.
That was my first JavaScript project.
It was a great JavaScript project. Yeah. Now you're on the dark side, aren't you?
What is dark?
JavaScript. We don't need to go into this. But anyway, so these weekly type languages, I mean the website that have has examples on there, it'll show you the tables underlined, et cetera. Yeah. But there's many elements in Killer Video. There's entities, and then there's relationships. So let's walk through that a little bit. I apologize before I said entity relationship diagram, and a lot of people are like, where's the entity relationship diagram? Sorry, sometimes webinar software goes a little haywire, but here's another one.
Oh, we're going to blame the webinar software.
Well, I was going to blame you, but I'm saving that.
Okay.
So entity relationship diagram. This is an entity relationship diagram of Killer Video. And this should be familiar for you. Here's all the entities, here's the properties, and here's how they're related.
Okay.
This has nothing to do with the underlying physical data model. This could be for relational database. This could be for Cassandra.
Okay. Right.
It could be for really anything. And a key value store, maybe.
Why not?
It's just a way to describe your data. This is actually where I think if you're an architect, this is how you're trying to describe data for all the key stakeholders. Like, am I getting all this right? Are these the entities?
Yeah, right.
And this is a part of that application workflow that we talk about. So we could take this entity relationship diagram, and then we can move into the application workflow portion. So okay. Let's go to that.
Cool.
Okay, so this is a description of, I think, something that we always do. And when I talk about it with groups, they're like, oh, we do this. You don't just sit down and write a bunch of tables. Like, if you were building an application, you wouldn't go, let's go build all the tables in our Oracle database and then go from there. No, you probably talk about the actual application.
I actually had
you started with the database?
They told me that we had to have the entire data model for the whole application.
At one point,
all
though,
increments of development had to be done data modeled.
I noticed work there anymore.
It happens.
That's right. It does happen, and it's completely wrong, and you should never do that. You're going to have a discussion about what you're building.
Yeah.
And in those discussions about what you're building, you're also talking about the workflow, like, or the application flow. So here's an example. Like, you're not going to just show user data randomly. I'm not going to name names, but there are plenty of places out there that have done this inadvertently.
Yeah.
You're probably going to ask for a username and password before you show someone their profile information. That's an example of a workflow.
That's a really good practice.
Yeah, it's best practice.
Yeah, we'll do that.
Best practice,
here.
Yeah. But I mean, that shows you that there's a flow to the application. Like, you're going to have one thing before you have another. And just doing a basic mapping starts showing you these, not only the patterns, but also the key indicators. And so let's look at, what are those key indicators? Let's look at that.
That's cool. One thing that's really cool about this particular picture that I just wanted to say real quick is this is literally all of the access patterns.
Yeah.
In the whole application.
Yeah. This is real. This is, if you go look at the website, this is 100% what's there.
Right. So what we do is, once we've identified all of these access patterns, and it is helpful to have that, like we showed on the last slide, the relationships between them, like what is the sequence of operations. Somebody has to log in, and that unlocks other actions that they can perform on the user interface. So then we want to look at each one of those access patterns and what is the query that is behind it. So on this slide, we see that there are some queries associated with users. That's these entities that we showed a few minutes ago, right? Users, comments, and ratings is what we see on this slide. For users, we have two different ways that we want to access the data. One is finding a user by their email address. That supports the login use case. And then we also might later on want to be able to find information about that user by their ID. So there's two different queries. One of them is associated with checking their password and making sure that it's right on login, and the other one is associated with getting information about that user, what their name is, and maybe some descriptive information. Similarly, for comments, we have the ability to comment on videos in Killer Video. So either I'm looking at a video and I want to see the comments for that video, or I'm looking at a user's profile and I want to see all the comments that they've made or all the movies that they've commented on. And then ratings, we also have the ability to go in and give each video a star rating 1 to 5. So we want to be able to look at the ratings that are organized by video. The next slide has, we couldn't fit all the access patterns on one slide, but.
Well, I think this is an interesting one too,
the
because.
Videos is the second set. Yeah, go for it.
Well, what I was going to say is we went direct entity one-to-one relationship with most of those other slides, but this slide, I mean, this shows more the dynamic nature of the data.
I have four different ways that I want to look up videos.
Right. So let's walk through those.
Okay, so I might want to look at videos by tag. So we do have the ability when we upload videos into Killer Video to tag it with keywords. Mm-hmm. You'll see lots of, if you go to the online version, you'll see lots of cat videos and lots of Cassandra videos.
Right, yeah.
We do have other tags that don't start with C.
But mostly cat videos and Cassandra videos.
That's also what you'll find there.
Yeah.
Okay, so you can find
and
a video
by
Baby
tag. Yoda. We have some Baby Yoda videos now, too.
What?
That's true. Yeah.
That's
Baby Yoda's the new cat video. You know that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We'll find a way to work more Baby Yoda in somewhere.
Okay.
Okay. Videos by tag, that was the first one. Second one, finding videos by date. We want to actually see the latest videos. Mm-hmm. The most recently added videos to the platform, because everyone wants to see the hot new stuff. That's another way we want to access videos. A third way is looking up a video by its ID, because we want to get all the information, let's say the detailed description, the actual video feed, the preview image, etc. And then the fourth way is we want to actually look up videos by user, because again, I want to go to that user profile page and find everything they've uploaded.
Right.
That's four different ways of accessing video. You could probably guess what that's going to lead to.
Right.
But we'll tease that.
What will
it
lead to?
Oh. Well, it'll lead to specific table designs, which is our next topic that we're going to go to. So once we've identified all those access patterns and we've begun to word those in the context of queries, like I'm going to need to access this particular entity by this particular attribute. Right, entity by attribute, that's a pattern. We're gonna end up creating a Cassandra table for each one of those particular queries. So why don't you talk me through what this would look like if I was doing a relational data model, and then I'll contrast the Cassandra way.
Sure, so back to the relational databases. And I touched on this earlier, and when we're building relational data models, we do have this opportunity for normalization, right?
Yes.
That's the opportunity.
It's an opportunity.
The opportunity. Third normal form, fourth normal form, fifth normal form. You ever use fifth normal form?
By no means.
Yeah, you got to be into really hardcore data mart stuff, like star schema.
Yeah.
All right. So third normal form, and that's pretty typical. But what it requires is that we separate out data. For instance, the users versus their logins or whatever.
Okay.
And what we do is foreign keys to create those relationships.
Okay.
And you can set up relational integrity, et cetera, but it does require you to break that out. I think that's pretty normal, right?
Yeah.
So we have a different way of doing it with Cassandra, though. And we're going to have to migrate that thinking. But what I think is really fascinating is even though the third normal form is something we use in relational databases all the time,
yeah.
As well, that's the way they're built, right? My last few years of working with relational databases, I rarely used normalized data because it was just too slow.
Too slow, right. So you just didn't bother anymore.
So actually one of the reasons I went to Cassandra is because I was at this point where I couldn't denormalize any more of my tables and get the speed that I needed.
Ah, okay. Gotcha. So classic relational approach would be, okay, what's my users table? And if I need to access that in multiple different ways, I'm going to start adding indexes so that I can look up based on different columns.
And it's very columnar, right? So
you
look at the field and you're looking up the field. And that's one of the features that's really fascinating about relational databases is that they just allow a lot of things to be cool, which may be kind of anti your application performance guidelines.
The flexibility is great until you design a query that
you can index every single field, right?
You could.
Yeah. How's that working for you?
Not great.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's talk about the Cassandra way. This is the way.
The way, yeah.
Yes. Okay. We have two access patterns.
Right.
We're going to end up with two tables. So table on the left, is user credentials. Mm-hmm. It supports the login use case. So that access pattern is, I have an email address. Someone's logging in. They provide an email address and a password. I'm going to go look up a record. Look, we are storing the passwords encrypted. We're storing encrypted passwords, okay?
I'm sure you're using two-factor authentication.
Totally, we are doing this, right? No, literally, we are. We are encrypting the password as we store it in the actual implementation of Killer Video. So the email address is the entire primary key. So I don't have any clustering columns. I just have an email address, which is a partition key. And so each partition has one row in it. Very simple. We're going to look up the user's basic information. It's basically just the email so that we can find the row, the password so that we can encrypt what they sent us when they're logging in and make sure it's the same. And then what we're going to get back, the key piece of data that we're trying to retrieve to unlock other use cases, is that UUID, the user ID, unique ID. Okay. The second access pattern is I want to, like, the user is logged in and they want to go to their profile page.
Mm-hmm.
So in that case, they've already logged into the app. We should already have that user ID. So now we can use that as the primary key of this user's table on the right.
That's your application workflow working for you now.
Exactly.
Yes.
So I had that one table that I got that key piece of information on login, which is the user ID that unlocks a bunch of other accesses for me. So this is how it works.
Right.
So when I log into the site, you see on the right, there's a sign-in button at the upper right. If I've already created an account, I'm going to provide my email address and password. We're going to go look up into the user credentials table by that email so that we can compare the password, get back the user ID, then I'm logged in. And that unlocks all the other things that I can do, get my user profile, get all the videos that I personally added to the system, and I can also see all the comments that I posted on different videos. Oh, that's all keyed off of that user ID.
And I think as a feature of denormalization at this point, you are duplicating data.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
So this is the trade-off.
We'll do more of that.
Yes. I think this is where a lot of folks go, we're duplicating data, right? We can't do that. But yes, we can, because we're changing the equation.
Right.
I think back in the day when disk space was really expensive, that was actually when relational databases started normalizing data, was to reduce the amount of disk storage, because it cost $1 million for a megabyte.
Right.
Disk space is not the problem anymore. Your problem is your speed and uptime.
Our costliest resource is time.
Time, yeah. Tell your users that you're saving disk space and their website is slow.
Spinning wheel.
It'll be great.
It's no good.
Yeah, you won't be a website anymore. But I just thought I would add that, because I see these coming up a lot, and boy, that's a common question.
So one of the things, I'm anticipating a question that may be rolling in, which is, how did the data get into these tables? Like, I was just showing the reads that hit the user's table and the user credentials table. How did that data get there to begin with? Well, we have another use case, which is the register use case. If I go to the Killer Video website, go to the upper right, hit the register button, I'm going to get this little window that you see here on the left. I'm going to give my username, I'm sorry, my first and last name and my email address, the password I want, and retype my password, because good best practices, right? That information is then written out to two different tables. So Killer Video takes that when you register, and it writes a row into user credentials, and it writes a row into users.
Yep.
Are you worried about that? Some people get worried about that.
Well,
what happens
techniques.
If my application dies in between those writes?
Well, is we have techniques to get to that.
Okay.
Yeah, so we won't cover it as much here, but this is a concept of using a batch.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
So, yeah, and if we come back, I want to come back and do another one of these where we look at some of the code aspects of doing this. We're just going to keep it to data model today.
Yes.
So we'll come back and talk about that.
Yeah, we're covering the basics. These are things that you should definitely pay attention to, but by all means, we can't cover every aspect in an hour.
Right.
Yeah.
But you know what we can cover? This question. So this is one of the most common questions that we get. Thank you, Hugo, for sending us this question into us. How do I plan for future queries and use cases?
No. Everyone's expected to do it perfectly the first time. That's the entry rules. You can't use Cassandra unless you're perfect.
Oh, wow.
I'm kidding, of course. Nobody's perfect. And yeah, This is a good question, though, because I think it helps also get us past how we denormalize and how application workflows go.
Okay.
So I'd say the first and foremost thing is understanding what an application workflow actually is. Right. But you'll learn soon with an application workflow that you're somewhat immune to big changes because you're adding features, you're not changing them.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
And adding features is totally fine because you can just keep branching off of that application workflow.
Right.
And so you're just adding more tables, more data, et cetera.
Or more columns to an existing table, maybe?
Potentially, yeah, doing an alter table and changing columns.
Yeah.
The biggest change is whenever you're completely rearranging your data. And so I think we have a slide on that.
We're going to talk about that one
sure.
more later. Okay, but yeah, I think that you're right. So the short answer is that modeling that application workflow really helps you a lot.
Right.
To not create some dead ends for yourself.
You can't join your way out of it, though. Which
no.
I think is good.
Well,
when I was a DBA.
Wait two slides, because I'm going to argue with you just a tiny bit for fun.
All right.
I'm setting you up.
Well, I'm just thinking about the time when I was a DBA, and I would see like this query on their slow query log keep popping up.
Yeah.
And it's because somebody on the front end team decided that they didn't want to change their data model and just join their way out of it.
They didn't really need to talk to anyone else, yeah.
And they put it on the front page.
Right.
Like, oh, my website.
Okay, I'm not trying to defend that.
Let's
be clear. So now we're going to look at some of the videos. Remember that we identified four different access patterns for videos, four different ways that we wanted to load video data. Here are the first two of them. Okay, so we want to see finding a video by its ID. So we've designed a table here that's the videos table on the left. If you look all the way down at the bottom left, the primary key for this table just has a partition key. It's the video ID. I'm going to go straight to that row once I know that video ID,
mm-hmm.
and I'm going to get all these columns here that you see are available to me at the application to query. So I get the user ID that uploaded that video, the name and description of the video, the location, that's an actual URL. We cheated a little bit when we implemented this, and it's a YouTube URL.
It is.
So we are definitely leveraging off of another video sharing system. That's for our implementation because this is a reference app, right? There's also a preview image location, and then we're using a set collection. So Cassandra has some collections, which we'll get to in a minute, to see the set of tags associated with that video. And then one other key piece of information is when that video was added. That comes into play even more importantly in some other tables. So that's the basic videos table. You have to know the ID of a video in order to get that. So this is one of those things where there are multiple access patterns in our workflow that are chained together. There are other tables which are going to allow us to get those video IDs so that we can come hit this video and get it by ID.
And I think this is one of the, here's a moment of anxiety.
Yeah.
Because I now have two tables with the same information in it mostly.
Right.
How do I keep this data synchronized as a source of truth?
Why don't I put an index on this so I can search by name?
Right, exactly. Mm-hmm. Well, and the source of truth thing is probably another one of those common questions that come up.
Right.
Just alleviate some fears. Cassandra is used as a source of truth at some of the most important places on the planet.
Right.
This is not an unknown thing. There are techniques to synchronize tables. For instance, I mentioned a batch. Batches guarantees that it writes that data to those tables. And we're not going to dig, I think this will probably
is that
be
a transaction?
Really, it is a transaction of sorts.
Okay.
But it's not an ACID transaction.
Okay, important, yeah.
So because in a distributed database, multi-partition, you're not going to have that across, but you will get guarantees.
Right.
There's consistency guarantees or synchronization guarantees. And that's what the application developer really needs to know is, when I put the data in there, it goes in the database. And if it doesn't, I know about it. Probably another good webinar of like how to maintain my source of truth.
Nice. I like that. We're getting so much out of this. We're
I
doing
know.
A webinar and we're brainstorming other webinars.
Well, it because, you
this
know,
how we do our planning here.
I say this all the time. The biggest banks in the world love Cassandra.
Yeah.
Ooh. That could be another webinar. But
I like it. Wow. Okay.
Woo!
The idea fairy is going crazy.
But I mean, and I want to So yes, there are ways to do this. Batches are one of the ways to do it, of course. And then there's ways to manage it inside a single table. But for now, we'll move on. But it is something we can do.
Cool.
All right, so I told you a table in which you must know a video ID in order to get a lot of information about a video. Another way that we want to access videos is by user. So I want to be able to get a list of all the videos that a user has uploaded.
Right.
So for that, again, looking down here at the bottom on the right side, the primary key for this table is user ID. So that's going to build a partition with all of the videos for a user by one user ID. And then I have two clustering columns, added date and video ID. And I've put added date as my first clustering column in descending order. And that's going to allow me to get the most recently uploaded videos by that user first. So if I end up having, if they've uploaded hundreds of videos and I end up with multiple pages of data of videos, I'm going to be getting the most recently added ones first. And then there's one more piece of information that I need, which is that video ID. And that is in there so that I have a unique row for each video.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that that's sometimes taken care of for you by using the same partition key.
Right.
The idempotency of data in a distributed system like this is really critical for that. So another great topic.
All right, so I mentioned a second ago that we were cheating in our implementation of this by storing a URL to another location of binary video data. This is a legit technique, right? I could use Cassandra for all my metadata and then maybe store the actual bits and bytes of the video in an object store, in an S3 bucket or whatever. But can you store binary data in Cassandra?
Well, yeah, there's a blob data type.
Yeah.
And it's every database should have blob. But it's one of those fields that I think if you reason out, you're not going to put 2 gigs of data in there, which you could. But do you really want to put that on your application in your network, storing that amount of data inside of your database? Probably not the right technique.
And, no, right.
And so reasonable is like hundreds of K, maybe,
right.
Of blob data. A typical use with that would be like, I've seen this with like mobile applications where you'll gzip the JSON payload that doesn't need to be parsed and put it in a blob.
Okay.
So you have a small, like 1-2K blob sitting into your denormalized data set for a user. Like, here's all my user preferences in a blob, and it goes right into the application.
Okay, right. So I think if you have a larger size blob, you could either put it somewhere else, or you could break it up into chunks.
Yeah, like, and this is another one. This is a public use case. Intuit. Text during tax time when you. They store, when you file your taxes, they store all your documents.
Okay.
Well, they use Cassandra to store the metadata for that, but then they use Ceph to actually store the bits.
Okay.
So it's like this is what works here, and the reasons are obvious. I think it's because that they're two different use cases and they're blending those together.
Got it. Okay.
Or an S3 bucket or something like that. Yeah.
Thank you for allowing me that rabbit trail.
Yes.
Yeah, more video tables. So one of the concerns that people have is, okay, if I'm storing data in multiple tables, like you've already seen, I've shown you on that last slide, I'm storing the video description and the title in multiple tables. So what if somebody wants to edit a video title or description? Then I do need to go change it in all those locations.
Yeah, that's... I think that's also a technique,
right?
And how you manage that from a batch is probably the right. Also from a database standpoint, but also it's an application. Like when you build access patterns,
right,
in your database, there's some software design choices and microservices with cloud native data that makes sense.
Okay. So yeah, let's look at a little bit of how that works from a couple different perspectives.
Mm-hmm.
So the first one is we want to be able to tag a video, and we might be able to apply multiple tags to it. Collections are a good way to do that. The most frequently used and most recommended collection would be a set, because then you have unique values. So I could tag a video with cats or Cassandra, and I'm just going to drop those in that set. That's very highly extensible.
Collections are the way to add dynamic data to your denormalized static data set. that's the formalism. But dynamic data is not unknown. Like tags is a great example. You know, I don't know, you know, there's 1, 10, 100, I don't know. But right. I don't want to have to build a table that I have to now set up a join condition for. It just doesn't make any sense at that point. So right. why right. not just put it into a single field in that entity table?
So how many elements would I put into a collection before I started thinking about whether that was too many?
Well, keep in mind that every time you do a read from that table, it's going to have to read that entire data set, including a collection.
If so I grab that tags column, then I'm going
it's grabbing all of it. Yeah. So the limit is 64,000. Uh-huh. You may recognize that number. Who would need more than that?
Integer?
Yeah, it's signed integer. You know, that's the hard limit.
Yeah.
But you just think about, like, well, if I'm putting hundreds of K worth of information in there, then that's your payload size. So just, hundreds of items
right.
or a certain capacity. And this is where load testing, which we'll get to in a minute, is really your friend, like understanding these things. You could
All
put
right,
a big...
Well, don't steal your own thunder. Okay, here's what...
Thunder.
This is the fight that I've set you up for here. With this,
we're going to fight? Okay.
Slide. So notice here that... In order to assemble the page that's kind of in the background
yes.
on this slide, there is actually an access to the videos table and the users table. So I clicked on a video. I knew its video ID.
Right.
And then when I loaded that video's record, that again, I then got the user ID of the person that uploaded that video. Now, I do not yet, this isn't my name, but it just says Jeffery. And it's spelled kind of funny, but
it's your alter
weird.
Ego.
Yeah, it's yeah, weird.
The guy who likes client side joins.
The fake user that the test data generator created when it uploaded this video into Killer Video. The fake user Jeffrey. We don't have that information in the videos table.
Right.
The name of that user is not present there.
Right.
So I got the user ID when I got that video record. Now I can go to the users table and I can pull. And find out that user's actual name is Jeffrey whatever, can't see, too small, need bifocals, et cetera,
right.
Old dad jokes. So this is an application level join. In order to build this page, I did have to make two queries to two different Cassandra tables. Good,
right.
bad, ugly.
I try to avoid client-side joins at all costs.
Okay.
And it's just because you're making two round trips to the database. And
right.
I, as an optimizer, I know, not premature, an right. optimizer, I like to make one call. So can we turn this into a denormalized
yes.
data set?
Yes, okay, so what I could do there is I could write the user first name, last name, and possibly even email into that videos table.
Right.
So this is a denormalization. So the trade-off is yeah. then I need to make sure that I have that information available when I write into the videos table. So that I could populate that correctly.
So and you could also use a like for instance a user defined type
okay.
of person
mm-hmm.
and have that in as the same thing as the other. Although you weren't not getting away with a whole lot. Either way, you're either going to do a client side join or you're going to set it in two places.
Okay.
I do like using a user defined type though.
Right.
Yeah. But that's a separate discussion.
Okay. And I do like including photos of videos of you.
Oh, well, that, yeah. fun fact, that's yeah. our Cassandra contributor meeting. If you're interested in contributing to Apache Cassandra, we have a meeting every month.
Happens monthly.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's on the apache.cassandra.org website.
Cool.
Yep.
All right. Let's talk about ratings and how those work in the Killer Video system. So on the upper right, you see, click on the Apache Cassandra contributor meeting, and that takes me to that page we were just looking at. This is a little zoom in on the upper right of that that shows that this video has, funny enough, has only been rated 2.0 out of 5 stars on average by fake users generating test data alone on the system.
We should fix that.
Yeah, we should. So this is one possible way to accumulate ratings is to use Cassandra's counter type. Now,
yep.
you wouldn't want to use this for your bank balance because it's incrementing and decrementing counters is not an idempotent operation, meaning that if you tried to increment a counter and it timed out, and then you tried to increment it again because you wanted to retry that, it's not deterministic whether or not it would have already been incremented or not. You don't know because it timed out.
Yeah, if you say add twice, it does twice.
That's not idempotency. Well, I don't know if the first one failed.
True.
If the first one timed out, then I don't know if it added it or not. So yeah. For that reason, okay, don't use it for your bank balance. However, if you want to just use it as an aggregator of things like likes, which is why Twitter invented it when they first invented and added it to Cassandra.
Yeah.
So we're using it to aggregate ratings. So I go in and I click on a video to rate it on a scale of 0 to 5 stars, or I guess I can't pick 0, 1 to 5 stars. Then when I do that, what's going to get written out to the database is I'm going to write out a total value of all of the ratings. So I'm going to literally add somebody rated it 2, somebody rated it 5. I'm going to add 2 plus 5 is 7. I'm just going to aggregate that. And then I have a total of 2 ratings. So in order to calculate this 2.0 average rating that you see on the screen, I would have gone and gotten the total sum of all the ratings and divided it by the total. That's just the simple algorithm that we're using to aggregate this stuff, right?
Oh, you can also use the built-in features for user-defined functions.
You could use a user-defined function, is like a stored procedure.
It's like a stored procedure, but it's also like the built-in aggregation functions as well.
Yes. Okay, so we could have had Cassandra do that for us.
Right, query.
We could actually ask Cassandra to compute the average for us.
Yeah, sum, average, min, max, those are all built into Cassandra.
Which is pretty cool. We didn't do it that way. We actually did it in the application, but trade-offs, right?
Right.
So for this, the table design that you see there on the left is actually not possible because counters are a unique sort of thing in Cassandra. They can only be included in a table where only counter. You only have columns that are counter besides the primary key columns.
That's mainly why we call them counter tables. Okay. Because that's the only thing you get to do there.
So video ratings is really what we call a counter table.
Yeah, and it's just because you can't mix types. And there are reasons, and it's mainly because counters are considered a CRDT.
Don't take me under the hood right now.
Oh, I'm going there. CRDT.
Okay.
I said it.
Maybe you should do a webinar on CRDTs.
Oh, I think I have.
Nice.
Yeah.
All right, so one of the questions that we also get is, should I use Cassandra for time series data storage? Is that a good thing or a bad thing? You could probably tell where we're about to go. Because, of course, the answer is going to be yes, right?
But I use it all the time.
Right. You want to tackle the different pieces of this? There's another little question about compaction strategy. We gave Varun the chance to ask 2 questions. It's a compound question.
It's almost related.
Yeah.
Right. So Cassandra as a time series database is awesome. It has the right storage and the way that it stores data, the velocity that it stores data, the scalability and the availability is just form fit for a lot of those use cases. Especially in things like fraud detection, where you don't want to lose data and you can't miss anything. But in the case where, like, how would you do it? I think there's some. Did we have a
You're
slide
on fire right now? I don't know if our side.
Oh yeah, if you can hear the background. it's amazing to me how many data models turn out to be time series models anyway.
Okay.
Because they have a time component and.
Like how long is this data useful for?
For instance, I think if you look at time series data and you say, well, what's a typical use case? You go to IoT.
Mm-hmm. But, oh, it happened at this point in time.
Yeah, it's temperature measurement and
sensor data.
Collection. Yeah. I have a project out there, for the old one, Killer Weather, that it was just around time series measure or time measurement with or temperature measurement of time. And sure, great, aggregations. But there are little things, like let's look at the next one. Killer Video, it has some time series in it.
Okay.
So
there's a hiding right in plain sight.
Yeah, I need a list of all the videos that were uploaded. That's a time series model, right? And that is a subtle time series model. So let's get into the question of like, all right, what is, based on that, what would be the right compaction strategy?
Yeah.
The idempotent long-term time series data compaction. There is compaction. We're getting into the weeds a bit, but yeah, you may want to use something like time window compaction strategy.
Okay.
If it's something more like this video table where there's a time component to it, I would stick with your more traditional like level or size tier compaction.
Okay, got it. So you have like chunks of data that you want to kind of expire together.
Right. That's
over
time. Time
like last hours or.
Days, months, years.
Okay.
But there are there are some considerations with time series. And I think that this is one of the really good ones, is like, just understand that if you look at the way the partition key works and clustering columns, look at all you can do with that. Mm-hmm. You're co-locating large groups of data together. Okay. And it gets into partition sizing, conversations, et cetera. But yeah, we should move on to the next one, because I could do a whole webinar on time series data.
Oh, I want to hear that. Okay, so latest videos, it is partitioned by these date buckets. And then within those date buckets, we have all the rest of the information right about each video. Now, what if I'm getting millions of videos uploaded a day, and a date bucket is going to lead to a super wide partition? What do I do then?
Well, all right, so if the date bucket, all right, so let's say your resolution, data resolution is way too high, like millisecond data, and yeah. You need to break it up.
You need to break it up.
You're going to have a billion things in there in a day. Using like a synthetic way of breaking up your partition with a bucket number.
Yeah.
I really try to avoid that as much as possible, and I try to use with the data that I have to build that. If I have second resolution, maybe use that. If I have minute resolution, maybe use that.
Okay.
So I don't want to get into this. I don't want to just jump right into using synthetic keys. I want to, the data that I get will help create the key.
And part of it is, again, looking back at the query, how do I want to get the data back out? What is the amount of time range that I want to query over?
Right.
And then if I have too many buckets, then I have to go and hit that many different buckets and write that many queries.
Exactly.
So those are the trade-offs. All right. So we've actually talked through almost all of the killer video schema for this whole application. You can literally go to our GitHub project for a killer video. If you go to the killervideo.org on GitHub, there's various projects and there are various repos. And the killervideo-data is where you can find the schema for this thing.
Yeah.
And we were just talking about this as we were prepping before. The timestamp on this was, it was last modified
in 2016.
And Patrick was like, oh, that makes it look really obsolete. And I said, no. It's not, because we did all the care of actually modeling the application right and modeling all the workflows. We've been doing tons of development continuously on Killer Video since 2016 and even before that. We haven't had to modify the schema file in that long because we took the care to get it right the first time.
And it's a reference app. I mean, we try to express all the different forms of data in the data model,
right?
And the application just uses that. So, I mean, your mileage may vary,
yes.
Of course. But
I'm not going to say that you'll never have to change your data model. But
we're not perfect. 2016, we're done.
Well, we're pretty good.
Yeah.
Okay, so how do you look at a data model and know that it's a good data model? You can put all this thinking and try to figure things out and reason it out up front, but I have a question from a randomly selected user. How do I know if I have a good data model?
Wait a minute. That looks like you asked this question. Are you asking your own question?
No, it's from Anonymous.
Anonymous.
Okay. How do I know if I have a good data model that will scale up to millions of rows and beyond?
This is weak. All right. I feel like I'm being set up here. Well, all right. So first of all, size is a consideration for any partition. And this is where you... there's a very simple technique. The data you put in is the data that's stored on disk. And you want to try to keep that down to hundreds of megs per partition.
Okay.
That's general guidance. You can do more. And it's like you're looking at like, oh, well, if I have a lot more, then it could be a potential performance thing that we're like, now my P99s are higher. Do you want that? Maybe not. Keep it small.
Okay.
But in this case, it's always back down to test it. I mean, we have some great testing tools, the NoSQL bench, for instance. There's TLP stress. There's all these tools that are out there that can help you test your data model. And if you're building applications without putting it through any kind of rigorous performance testing, then good luck.
Yeah, you should probably.
Because what I think you'll find is that it's not just your data model. Sometimes you made some wrong assumptions along the way with the way your application patterns work. I've seen that happen. Or just basic assumptions on your hardware selection, whatever.
Okay, gotcha. All right, so we're starting to run short on time here. We set aside about an hour. Let's plan on staying on for a few minutes and answering as many questions as we can for people that want to stick around. For those folks that have to run, I'm going to share a few resources for you because I promised that I would give those to you.
Sure.
So, first one is DS220. Man, I just realized that I didn't put any pictures of me in here.
Yeah, the first
only
slide.
Pictures of you.
The first
slide. Yeah, that's right, at the very beginning. Yeah. So I wasn't trying to put you on the spot so much, but
you
tell us
totally
about
what,
you know, why I should take the data modeling course, DST 20.
Well, first of all, this is an hour-long discussion about data modeling, which is really right. important for you to understand it. But you are now technically dangerous.
That's right.
DST 20 is a very comprehensive course, and it's built on units, so you can skip around if you want to, but it's much more in-depth on each topic.
Okay.
And so it's a full course. It will. There's examples. There's just more hands-on to it. So I would recommend if you're really going to get serious about this, just go do this.
Okay. Yeah. This is where you need to go.
Right.
All right. We are also bringing our Cassandra Developer Workshop to a bunch of cities around the world. We're always looking to schedule. If you would like for us to come to your city, we can get a group of folks together to do an all-day hands-on workshop. We do talk data modeling. We also do application development. So you're using DataStax drivers,
right.
Either Java, Node.js, or my favorite, Python. I can't believe I just said my,
I thought it was JavaScript.
The Java part of me just died. Those are the three languages that we support in the workshop. We may add more later on, but reach out to us. Look on our events page for where we're going. And then if we're not coming anywhere near you, reach out and we'll see if we can come to your city.
Here's your open invitation. If you would love, if you're working at a company and you have space, like 100 to take, say, 100 people, 50 people, and you would love to invite some Cassandra community members as well, we will come to your location. We're doing this at Ticketmaster, for instance. They were very gracious. They have 100-person space. And they're like, well, we're going to bring our people, but you can bring anybody else, you know, so we're just doing an open call.
Great recruiting tool for your company, too. Wow.
It is. Yeah, if you want to find out who's interested in Cassandra, invite them into your lair. But, I mean, this is a great opportunity for you to get some hands-on, but also spend some time with engineers that work on Cassandra.
All right. Well, let's keep rolling for a few minutes and see how many of these questions, Q&A, that we can go through.
Yeah, I think we're at the end of the slide deck, but man, we got a lot of questions. So I'm going to tell you right now, we're not going to be able to answer all of these, but we will. We won't answer them all online, but we will. We'll have some method.
We will answer them all offline.
Yeah. Well. So how do we do that? We take all the questions and we answer them, and then what do we do with them?
Someone will be reaching out.
Well, my people will talk to your people. But I mean, we will. If you participated in this webinar, you'll get some Q&A output.
Yeah.
Which because, I mean, really, the questions are awesome because it shows where your head is, and it'd be great for your understanding.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Got it.
All right, so pick one.
Yeah, so let's get some. Does DS220 cover the time series model?
Not specifically. There's not a section on time series, but it does cover a lot of the techniques around time series data modeling. I would say doing a Google on Cassandra time series data modeling, you would probably find some YouTube videos out there about me talking about it in depth.
Right. There is a number of other resources, blog posts, and things available.
It's not an unknown topic. Yeah, killer weather, even though it's old, has a really good data model around it. So, yeah.
Got it. Okay, so can you discuss partitioning keys like in videos by user? Was there one? Should there be one? What do you think? There was one, and it was the partition key was the user ID. So we could get all of the videos that were uploaded by a particular user in one query if we wanted to.
Right. But the videos by user, okay, so but the user by video was user ID, video by user was, I'm sorry, the other way around.
Yeah.
Video by user, user ID. User by video was video ID. Those are the partition key changes.
Yes, right. And you could have both of those tables if you had access patterns for which you needed them.
Right, right.
I also have a question. Do you have foreign key relationships in Cassandra?
No. No foreign key relationships because this isn't a relational database. And there are a lot of technical reasons in a distributed database where foreign keys just don't work. But primarily, it's just based on the way that the system is designed.
Right. And foreign keys are really like something that I can have referential integrity on and be kept in sync across multiple tables. If you have this database that's part where you have data that's in different tables partitioned across different nodes, you could be asking it to go just about anywhere to like check those constraints.
Yes, and if you're talking about a 1,000-node cluster, you could have a really slow query going there.
Right.
Yeah, so we avoid that. I think in the future you'll see cases where it may be possible. This project is constantly moving, right, but not today.
Okay, we have another question here about how flexible is Cassandra for frequent changes in schema?
Oh, we just kind of answered that though. Well, maybe not. Frequent changes in schema, if you're doing alter tables,
yeah,
it's great for that, but when you change the partition, or when you change the primary key,
right,
you're gonna have to create a new table.
Okay. So that's the key distinction. Yeah, let's talk about that for a second. So if I change the way in which I want to look up data, that's essentially a new query that's supporting a different access pattern. Therefore, it's really a new table.
Yeah, and I think that's what freaks people out immediately. But there are some techniques to migrating from one table to another that's completely done online.
Okay.
I've spent a lot of time working on that over my years of consulting with Cassandra. One of the ways that I think is the most common is if you know you're going to have to make a radical change in your primary key, just go ahead and create that new table, move the data. You can use a little Python script because I know you love Python.
Right.
Move the data over. And because of the idempotency of the data, this is what works. Okay, you can do this online. Well, if you're using like a data access layer of some sort. But start doing shadow writes onto that table.
Okay.
And then eventually once you get these, you move the data and everything's synchronized, you can change your API call so that it's using that new table. These are ways that we can do live table migrations from an application layer. So I'm just going to add this. This is an area of community. If you're interested in making a contribution, this is a great area, schema migration. There are a lot of people doing interesting things. There's really interesting companies that help do interesting things, including DataStax. Hackalate is another company that does some cool stuff. We would love more input, and this is definitely a frontier area for Cassandra.
Okay. Wow. We're doing pretty well, but we have
one more question
that we haven't answered yet, so we have our work cut out for us.
Yeah, do you want to do one more question?
Why don't you pick one?
Oh, I got to pick one. All right. Yeah. Let's see here. There's so many good ones to pick from. I'm looking through this long list, and in a microservices environment, how does a team keep track of the duplicate data? This is a really interesting, I love microservices.
Yeah.
How does a team keep track of all the duplicate data that individual teams create in a denormalized structure where a lot of duplicate data gets created? Is a message broker a key to building a Cassandra app? Now we're getting into Cassandra app building techniques.
Yes.
Mr. Architect.
This totally is a great preview for us to do another whole entire session on. I would say that the short answer is not that a message broker is key necessarily. So I want to say yes, but if you're building a microservice application and each service is kind of like owning its own private tables, then I have seen some really, really creative designs using streaming technologies like Kafka, or you could use a message broker or message passing situation so that services are letting each other know what changes that they're making to data. We actually implemented this in Killer Video. There is some eventing. There's services with REST APIs. They're also firing off events when they're doing data changes, and services that subscribe to data so they can write data to other tables. So yes, it's a valid technique. You didn't ask, but yes, we'll do another session on this sometime in the future. So
yeah,
that's a good way to wrap up, though. I think that's a really good one to end on.
Yeah, well, and especially in a microservices environment, I mean, I would add in, make sure all your API calls are unique. Like an API per table is not a bad idea.
Okay.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
There's some tech.
I like an API per entity type that owns the tables that are underneath it, but that's just me. We can go argue architecture over lunch.
Let's do that, and then we'll do another presentation on what we came up with when we're all bruised and bloody and like, we won.
Awesome. Another question. I'm just going to keep firing at you. Is that all right?
Bring it on.
Okay. How do we fit an incremental application development where not all the queries are known at the start, and won't the tables get messy or simply just not suitable for new queries? Lino asks this question.
Yeah, that's that goes right into application workflow data modeling.
Okay.
And I think this is, and I mentioned it before, but I'm going to kind of use this as a good example to clarify. You're in a relational database, you may have to make changes to your foreign keys and things like that to change the data model, right? But with application workflow, because of the denormalized type of data, there's not a lot of changes you're going to make to those tables, right? Unless your application changes.
Okay.
So adding more functionality to your database or to your application will probably just generate more tables.
It tends to be additive, not
right.
change. Now, if you legitimately modeled something with like the wrong data type, that's an alter table, right?
It's an alter table, and that's managed in a single table. However, if you do something like you need to change your primary key, now you're migrating to a whole new table. There's, I think, just by the fact that how denormalized data works in Cassandra keeps it somewhat clean, but the mess is in migrating your data if you have to.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, wait, this is a really fun one. How would you change the killer video model if you had a user story that a video needed to be removed if it wasn't used within 30 days?
Ooh, that
like
sounds real world.
Stretching us here, yeah.
That sounds kind of real world. Like, but what kind of website or like videos like didn't watch it? You're out.
It's cutthroat. Cutthroat. We only want the most popular content. We don't need a long tail.
Yeah, I really, to tell you the truth, I think YouTube could implement this. I'm like, no one's watched this thing for a year. Get rid of it. So there's a couple of things. Let me ask you, Mr. Application Guy, where is your head on this? You got a couple ideas,
I'm
sure.
Well, my first idea was, I can use time to live, TTL.
Yeah, TTL is like 30 days, right?
Right. But then I realized that's not actually what the question is. If that were the question, how would you change it so that videos older than 30 days would expire? Perfect, I can totally do that. I can set a TTL of 30 days when I write the data in, and Cassandra will automatically clean that up for me behind the scenes 30 days later.
So I think,
what about this usage model?
Yeah, this is not a TTL, unfortunately. This is one that I would love to be a TTL, because TTLs are great.
Yeah.
Just fire and forget.
Right.
You say, this record disappears in 30 days. It does. But
it just does.
This is more along usage. So you can't just say, at 30 days, this thing is gone.
Okay.
There's probably a couple ways you could do this. And actually, I was thinking about, there's one way you can do it, is every time you access the video, you could use a TTL on this.
Okay.
And here's how.
Okay, tell me.
So you could, if you had a video in the video table, and every time you click on play, you do an update on this table and change the TTL for 30 days out.
Oh, that's going to generate a lot of data to compact.
Not that much. Yeah. It's one field. And you're updating a table, but you're just updating the TTL. And that TTL is row-based in this case, so you're good to go. It's going to generate more writes, because a TTL write is a write, or an update is a write. But I think this is the way to do it hands-off. The alternative would be to have a field that says last access date, and then have a reaper process go through and just clean everything out.
So then every time that it's accessed, I'm actually hitting that row and updating that column, which is the last access column.
Right.
Okay.
So that gives you a little more control over when those get reaped. And so there's a reaper process that does that.
Right.
But how do we remove the amount of infrastructure requirements?
And how you take load off of your application and let the database do the work for you. You always want to do that if you can.
And TTL is a free delete, pretty much. Yeah. Less than free. It just disappears.
Okay. Last one. You ready?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. How do I make changes to a data model when my application is already in production?
Ooh. Yeah, that's happened a few times.
I'm you're screwed.
No, you're not screwed at all.
Okay.
This happens all the time. Well, so what changes do you need to make? If you need to make an alter table, go for it. You know, that's totally doable. One thing you have to
I need to change my primary key.
Not doable. Okay. And we talked about this. This is that situation where you're like, my primary key is missing a clustering column, maybe. Or maybe the resolution isn't right on my clustering columns. It could happen. Maybe, hopefully you picked that out during load testing and the testing, but if you didn't, you're in production, you need to repartition your data based maybe on the partition size. That's pretty logical, right? Okay.
And I see this happen a lot of times with people that they have picked clustering columns and they think that they can query based on any of those, that they're right. almost like an index.
Right.
And they're really not.
Yeah. And then they're like, oh, that's the wrong table now.
Right.
Wah, wah. Well, okay, so that means you're going to have to create a new table
mm-hmm.
and migrate the data. So let me just go back and reiterate the technique that seems to be tried and true.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, I should just write this app. Actually, I think it's somebody did, and I need to find it. But what it is you have to create the new table with the correct data format.
Okay.
Migrate the data, do the writes into it. But then you also, in your access pattern, you just start doing shadow writes into that table. So shadow writes, online application, shadow writes into the table, migrate your data. Item potency is going to keep that overlap from being a problem.
Okay.
Because if you, let's say you're doing shadow writes,
yeah.
you start with shadow writes and it's writing a bunch of data in there, you can just go over to the existing source table and just write every bit of data into the other table, the new table.
Right.
And it's just going to overwrite it with the same data. So
there's
you don't
no
have
harm
to figure
done.
Out the cut point. No,
yeah,
just
yeah.
go for it.
Right. Okay.
And once you're satisfied that the writes are good and that the table is now accepting writes the way it should, flip the reads over, decommission the other table, applications online, Bob's your uncle.
Okay.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Mm-hmm.
Good answer.
This has been done a lot. And this is where you get to show a little kung fu, a little chop, where you can say, yeah, I know how to do applications online all the time. You can impress your friends and neighbors, at least your coworkers.
So we're definitely out of time for questions. Thank you for helping us max it out with a really enthusiastic response and tons of questions. So thanks for joining us, and we'd like to invite you to future DataStax events at datastax.com/webinars. And also be sure to check out the events page on the website for upcoming workshops and conferences and you know, all those opportunities for us to see you in person. So thanks for joining us today.